We learn a new concept that we do have in network theory, where my previous videos which we have discussed is on source transformation. We discussed on star delta conversion. Now we'll see how to use mesh analysis or mesh current analysis or loop analysis in solving the electrical network. Okay, so we'll learn today what is the mesh analysis, how mesh current analysis can be used to find out the loop currents or voltage or power using this particular loop analysis technique. Okay, so it can be called as mesh analysis, it can be called as mesh current analysis, or it can also be called as loop analysis. Okay, so first of all, you need to know what are the steps involved in analyzing the circuit using mesh analysis or loop analysis or mesh current analysis. So we need to know what are the steps involved in solving the problem using this particular technique. So first thing is, we need to find out the number of mesh present in the given network. Okay, so the first step is find the number of mesh present in the given network. Okay, and the second step is mark the mesh currents for each mesh by considering the direction of the current, either clockwise or anti-clockwise direction. So after finding out the mesh in any given network, the second job is, or the second step is, we need to mark the mesh currents for this particular mesh, either clockwise direction or anti-clockwise direction of the current. Okay, so if you take one mesh to be clockwise, then you should see through that all other mesh will be considered clockwise. Means the current in one mesh, if it is clockwise, all other currents in other mesh is also clockwise. If you mark the current in one mesh to be anti-clockwise, see through that the current direction in all other mesh is also anti-clockwise. So either you can make only clockwise directions, or you can use only anti-clockwise directions. You can't make one mesh to be clockwise, other mesh to be anti-clockwise. That is not possible. Okay. Now the third step is, write the KVL equation for each mesh separately. Okay. So the third step is, we need to write the KVL equation for each mesh separately. So we have marked mesh, we have marked mesh currents. Now our job is to write the KVL equation for those particular mesh. Now fourth question is, fourth step is, with these equations, represent the matrix. So we do write the matrix format with these equations. Okay, this equations is converted into a matrix. That is what we do. Why do we convert into the matrix is, that is what the fifth step will tell you. We are applying a Cramer's rule. I hope Cramer's rule is the mathematics concept which you people learnt in maths in first year. So you might be knowing what is Cramer's rule. Apply Cramer's rule for this matrix to find the mesh currents. Okay, so it's a very popular method where we normally use in matrix Cramer's rule to find the mesh currents. Okay, first thing is, we'll know what is Cramer's rule and how it has been applied. I'll just recall the concept for you, and then we'll see how to use this Cramer's rule in mesh analysis of any given electrical circuit. Now let us consider, we do have a matrix A which is of 3 cross 3 matrix. It means that you will have 3 mesh equations. The dimension of the matrix says the number of mesh equations, or the number of mesh also in the network. Okay, the dimension of the matrix will tell you the number of mesh or the number of mesh equations that you get in any given electrical network. Now this is the end result that you get. This matrix is the end result. Okay, so therefore after this matrix you need to apply Cramer's rule. So I am just telling you how the Cramer's rule is applied for this matrix matrices. Now this is the mesh equation that you write in terms of current. Okay, mesh equation will always be in terms of current, because KVL, when you write, you multiply resistance with current and that becomes the voltage across those resistance, right? So you get mesh equation in terms of current, whereas you get this voltage sources which are connected to each mesh. This 1, 2, 3, what you see in the matrix, this is the voltage source matrix which are connected into each mesh. Okay, now we have two matrices here. One is the mesh equation matrix and the other one is the voltage matrix. Mesh equation matrix will be the dimension of the number of mesh equations. Voltage matrix will always be one column, three rows. Okay, 3 × 1, 3 rows and 1 columns. The voltage matrix will always be 3 × 1, 3 rows and 1 columns. Okay, whereas the mesh equation matrix will be based on the number of mesh and number of mesh equations we write. So if we have two mesh and two mesh equations, then we'll write 2 × 2 matrix. Three mesh and three mesh equations, 3 × 3 matrix. Okay, so in that sense, the matrix mesh equation matrix will have the dimension. Now we all know that the Cramer's rule we find for mesh currents to find the mesh currents. So here in mesh analysis, we always find the mesh currents. Okay, so in Cramer's rule, we find mesh currents for the above matrix where I1 equals delta 1 by delta, I2 equals del 2 by delta, and I3 equals delta 3 by delta. Okay, so this is the Cramer's rule. The Cramer's rule says I1 equals delta 1 by delta, I2 equals delta 2 by delta, I3 equals delta 3 by delta. Now our job is to find out what is this delta and what is this delta 1, delta 2, delta 3. Okay, so here delta is the determinant of this particular matrix itself. Okay, delta is the determinant of the matrix A. Determinant of the matrix A is delta. Now first we see how to find out delta 1, delta 2, delta 3. Now the delta 1 is determinant of, you replace the first column of the matrix with the column matrix of this particular voltage. I'll repeat, you replace the first column of the matrix A with the column matrix of voltage V. Okay, so 1, 2, 3 will be replaced with this 1, 4, 1. So that is what I have done here, 1, 2, 3. Then these two columns remain as it is, 2, 5, 1, 3, 6, 2. Similarly, while finding out delta 2, you replace the second column, 2, 5, 1, with the voltage 1, 2, 3. Okay, you replace 251 with the voltage 123, and then you find out the determinant of that particular matrix. So 141 will be kept as it is now. 123 is what which is replaced with 251, and then 362 is the third column. So you find the determinant of this matrix. Similarly, to find out delta 3, you replace the third column 362 with 123 and keep other two columns as it is. So you replace 362 with 123 and keep other two columns as it is. So here delta 3 is determinant of that particular matrix 141, 251, 123. So you all know how to find out the determinant, right? So when I am finding out determinant of this 3 × 3 matrix, 1 into, you need to take first row always, 1 into 52s are 1 into 5 2s are 10 minus 6 into 1, right? 1 into 5 2s are 10 minus 6 into 1, so 1 into 10 minus 6 minus 2. See, this is plus minus plus. You need to consider first row, it is plus minus plus. Minus 2 into 4 minus 18. How? The second column and first row, if you leave, you will get 2 into 2, 6 into 3. Cross multiplication. 2 into 2 is 4, 6 into 3 is 18. Therefore, 2 into 4 minus 18. And then plus, I am saying plus minus plus. So, plus 3 into third column, first row, if you leave, you will be having this one. So, 3 into 2 into 1 is 2, minus 5 into 3 is 15. So, 3 into 2 minus 15. Now, if you find out the solution for this, you will get delta 1 to be equal to minus 7. So if you solve this, 10 minus 6 is 4, 4 minus 18 is 14 into 2 is 28. So plus 28 it will become, because the minus result you get inside this bracket. So 4 plus 28, 2 minus 15 is minus 13 into 3 is 39, minus 39. So you will be ending up with minus 7. Similarly, delta 2 is 1 into 2 into 2 is 4 minus 6 into 3 is 18. minus 1 into 4 into 2 is 8, 6 into 1 is 6, plus 3 into 4 into 3 is 12, 2 into 1 is 2. Therefore, that is what I have written here, 1 into 4 minus 18, minus 1 into 8 minus 6, plus 3 into 12 minus 2. Similarly, delta 3 is 1 into, so you should leave first column and first row, so 1 into 5, 3 is a 15, minus 2, 1 is a 2. Similarly, minus 2 into, leave second column, first row, you get 4 into 3, 12, minus 2 into 1 is 2. Plus 1 into, so you leave third column and first row, you will get 4 into 1 and 5 into 1. So that is what I have written there. Therefore, you get delta 1 to be equal to minus 7 if you solve. Delta 2 is equal to 14 you get, and delta 3 equals minus 8 you get when you solve it. Okay. Now find out what is delta, determinant of the actual matrix itself. So you get 1 into 5 into 10, 2 is 10. Minus 6 into 1 is 6, minus 2 into 4 into 2 is 8, minus 6 into 1 is 6, plus 3 into 4 into 1 is 4, minus 5 into 1 is 5. So therefore delta, you get minus 3. Now our job is to find out, so we found delta 1, delta 2, delta 3, we found delta. Our job is to find out what is I1, I2, I3. Now I1 is delta 1 by delta, minus 7 by minus 3. So you get I1 to be equal to 73 by amps. Similarly, I2 is delta 2 by delta, 14 by minus 3. I2 we get minus 14 by 3 amps. So similarly, I3 is delta 3 by delta, which is minus 8 by minus 3. Therefore, I3 you get 8 by 3 amps. Now this is how you find out the mesh current equation, mesh current values using the Cramer's rule at the end of every problem. Okay. Now we'll move on to the problem. Problem 1. Okay. So for the circuit shown below, use mesh analysis and find all the mesh currents. That is the question is been asked. Okay. So you can make a note of this particular circuit by pausing the video. So here 7 volts is the voltage source, 6 volts is another voltage source here, we have 2 ohms, we have 1 ohm, we have 3 ohm, we have 2 ohm and 1 ohm. This is the circuit given. Now you need to find out how many number of meshes that we have in this particular network. So how many mesh we have in this particular network, that is what we need to find out. Okay, mesh is something related to loop, but it is not exactly the loop. Okay, mesh is something related with the loop, but it is not the loop exactly. So why? Because mesh is always a loop which doesn't have any inner loop. I'll repeat, mesh is always a loop which will not have an inner loop. Okay, which will not have an inner loop. So before finding out the mesh, let us consider the number of loops that we have in this particular problem. So this is one loop, say 1 ohm, 3 ohm, 2 ohm, this is one loop, 3 ohm, 2 ohm, 1 ohm and 6 volts, this becomes another loop, right, this becomes another loop. Then you have 7 volts, 1 ohm, 6 volt, 2 ohm, this becomes another loop, right, this becomes another loop. Then you have this entire, you know, loop, where 1 ohm, 2 ohm, 6 volts, 1 ohm, 2 ohm. This will become another loop. Okay. Now loop can have an inner loop. That is the definition of the loop. Loop is what? When any closed path is formed, then that becomes a loop. Therefore, loop is different, mesh is different. Now again, you will have this outer loop. Again, see, you have this outer loop. Again, you will have this loop like 7 volt, 2 ohm, 6 volts, 3 ohm, 2 ohm, and then this can also be a loop. So therefore, you will have many loops in any given problem. But for us here, we need to find out the mesh. So how many mesh we have here is, we have only 3 mesh in this particular network. Because mesh will not have an inner loop. That is what the equation is. So therefore 1 ohm, 3 ohm, 2 ohm, if you take this loop, we don't have any inner loop inside that. right? 1 ohm, 3 ohm, 2 ohm. If you take, we don't have any inner loop inside that. So this can be one mesh. This can be one single mesh. Now coming to 3 ohm, 1 ohm, 2 ohm, 6 volts. This loop can be a mesh because we don't have any inner loop. So therefore, this is a mesh, second mesh. Now 7 volts, 1 ohm, 6 volts, 2 ohms. This is the third mesh because we don't have any inner loop inside that. Okay, so first mesh is this, second mesh which we have found is this, third mesh is this. We found this. Okay, now we'll see if there is any other mesh. So we do have outer loop also, right? So outer loop cannot be a mesh because we have these two mesh inside that particular loop. We have these two loop inside this outer loop, so therefore outer loop cannot be a mesh. Again, if you take out this particular loop where 1 ohm, 6 volt, 2 ohm, 1 ohm, 2 ohm, no, it is not possible because inside this loop we have two more loops here. So therefore, mesh is only three mesh we have in this problem because we have only three mesh which doesn't have any inner loop. One is this, and the other one is this. Okay, now as we found there are three mesh, our job is to mark the mesh currents. So here first I marked I1 for this mesh, I2 for this mesh, and I3 for this mesh. I had taken all mesh currents to be clockwise here. So I always take the mesh currents to be clockwise. So if you take anti-clockwise, the arrow direction will be in reverse order. And all currents should be anti-clockwise if you take anti-clockwise. So all three currents should be either clockwise or all three currents should either be anti-clockwise. So from my discussion from now will always be current in clockwise. Keep this in mind. Now why clockwise and anti-clockwise is very important here is when you take clockwise, when current passes through this particular voltage source, you take plus 7. But when you take anti-clockwise, when the current passes through this voltage source, you take minus 7. So this is how it is very important. So therefore, all mesh currents should be equal to anti-clockwise or clockwise, so that the property of the circuit doesn't change. Because the final answer, if you get plus 3 amps in clockwise, you get minus 3 amps in anti-clockwise. Only the polarity gets changed, but the solution of the answer should remain same. Okay, solution of the answer should remain same. Okay, all right. So the step one is write the mesh currents which we have done. So first we need to find out the number of mesh and then mark all the mesh currents in clockwise or anti-clockwise which we have done now. Now the next step is we write KVL for mesh, each mesh. So the first KVL that I write is for A, B, E, F, A. So this is the mesh. A, B, E, F. Back to A. So that forms a loop. Okay, we'll write the equation for that particular mesh in the beginning now. First equation. So I'll take the current clockwise now, going through the 7 volts first. So it is plus 7, coming towards 1 ohm. Now, this 1 ohm resistor is between I1 and I2. Okay, 1 ohm resistor is between the mesh 1 and mesh 2. Therefore, while writing the equation for mesh 1, I will say minus 1 into I1 minus I2 is the current flowing through 1 ohm. Okay, when I am writing the equation for mesh 1, I am repeating again. When I am writing the equation for mesh 1, I will write 1 into I1 minus I2. Okay, 1 into I1 minus I2. If I am writing mesh equation for I2 here, second mesh, I will write 1 into I2 minus I1. So whichever the mesh equation you are writing, that mesh current, you try to take the direction and write the equation. So therefore 7, so plus 7, then coming to 1 ohm, voltage drop comes, so minus 1 into I1 minus I2, then come towards 6 volts, it is minus 6 because plus to minus. So this large line says plus and small line says it is minus. So even the voltage source is mentioned even in this symbol also. Earlier we have discussed with circle and polarity, right? This is also a symbol which is used to represent voltage source. So plus minus, okay? So minus 6, minus 2 into, now this 2 ohm is between
mesh 1 and mesh 3. As I am writing equation for mesh 1, I will say minus 2 into I1 minus I3. Understood? Which is equal to 0. We don't have any other components here, so therefore equal to 0. So I will repeat, plus 7 minus 1 into I1 minus I2 minus 6 minus 2 into I1 minus I3 equals 0. Now you separate all I1, I2, I3 terms and take the numerical value to the right hand side. Keep I1, I2, I3 to the left hand side and numerical term to the right hand side. So I get minus 3 I1 plus I2 plus 2 I3 equals minus 1. Okay. So if you subtract minus here, what will we get? Plus 3 I1 minus I2 minus 2 I3 equals 1. So either any equations you can keep. Okay. Coming to second equation for second mesh. Okay. Second equation for second mesh. So what will you write? Always I'll take minus for resistance if I take. So minus 1 into minus 1 into. Now I am writing equation for mesh 2. So minus 1 into I2 minus I1. Okay, earlier we wrote I1 minus I2 when we were writing mesh current equation for I1. Now I am writing mesh current equation for I2. Therefore, I'll say minus 1 into I2 minus I1. Why minus 1? Because voltage drop will occur across the resistors always. So always I'll take the drop to be negative. Okay, minus 1 into I2 minus I1. Minus 2 into I2 because this is the resistance which is present only in this particular mesh. So minus 2 into I2. Minus 3 into, now 3 is between I have mesh 2 and mesh 3. So therefore minus 3 into I2 minus I3 equals 0. So we have only 3 components in this particular second mesh. So we will write equation for the 3 components. I'll repeat, minus 1 into I2 minus I1 because it is between mesh 2 and mesh 1. Minus 2 into I2 because it is only in mesh 2. Minus 3 into I2 minus I3 because it is between mesh 2 and mesh 3. So therefore, if you do that, so minus 1 into I2 minus I1, minus 2 I2, minus 3 into I2 minus I3, you solve for I2, I1, I2 by separating all these terms, you get I1 minus 6 I2 plus 3 I3 equals 0. Or you can write minus I1 plus 6 I2 minus 3 I3 equals 0. Both are same. Okay, fine. Two equations. Now, third equation, which is 6 minus 3. So, how will we get? Again, go back to the mesh current diagram. So, here this is the mesh current which we will be writing the equation now. So, here minus 3 into, so I am trying to take 3. Okay, minus 3 into I3 minus I2 now. Because you are writing the mesh current equation for the third mesh. Therefore, it is minus 3 into, why minus 3? Because voltage drop across the resistor always. Minus 3 into I3 minus I2. Minus 1 into I3 because this 1 is only related to mesh 3. Minus 2 into I3 minus I1. Plus 6 equals 0. Why? Because 2 is between mesh 3 and mesh 1. Therefore, minus 2 into I3 minus I1. Plus 6 equals 0. I'll repeat, minus 3 into I3 minus I2, minus 1 into I3, minus 2 into I3 minus I1, plus 6 equals 0. So that is what we have done here. So therefore 6 minus 3 into I3 minus I2, minus 1 into I3, minus 2 into I3 minus I1 equals 0. So you separate all these I1, I2, I3 terms and solve it. You will end up in getting 2 I1 plus 3 I2 minus 6 I3 equals minus 6, or you can say minus 2 I1 minus 3 I2 plus 6 I3 equals plus 6. Or not the same. Okay, so you are just multiplying a negative symbol to this equation. So if you multiply negative symbol to this equation, you should also do the same for other two equations. Keep this in mind. Okay, therefore I'll mark all the three equations now. I'll write it again. So how to write the matrix format of this equation is what we need to know to apply Cramer's rule. So minus 3 I1 plus I2 plus 2 I3 equals minus 1. I1 minus 6 I2 plus 3 I3 equals 0. 2 I1 plus 3 I2 minus 6 I3 equals minus 6. So now we'll write the matrix format of this equation. Okay, so very simple. Take the coefficients of i1, i2, i3 and put that into the matrix. So the first equation says minus 3, 1, 2 into i1, i2, i3. So if I multiply this, what will I get? Minus 3 into i1 plus 1 into i2 plus 2 into i3 equals minus 1. So therefore, you get the first equation. Therefore, minus 3, 1, 2. Minus 3, 1, 2 into i1, i2, i3 equals minus 1. Similarly, 1 minus 6, 3. 1 minus 6, 3 into i1, i2, i3 equals 0. Equals 0, you see here. Similarly, 2 into i1 plus 3 into i2 minus 6 into i3 equals minus 6. So 2, 3, minus 6, minus 6. So 2, 3, minus 6 into i2, i3, i1, i2, i3 equals minus 6. Now this is the matrix format you got for this equation. If you multiply this matrix with i1, i2, i3 and equate that to these variables, you get the same equation again. Now this is the matrix A. Okay, this is the voltage matrix. Now you see I have to apply Cramer's rule to find out i1, i2, i3. As we did earlier, we know that i1 is delta 1 by delta, i2 is delta 2 by delta, i3 is delta 3 by delta. Now you all know what is delta. Delta is nothing but the determinant of the above matrix, this matrix. Determinant of this matrix is delta. So we'll see how to find out the solution now. So delta is minus 3 into, delta is the determinant of the actual matrix. Minus 3 into minus 6 into minus 6 is 6, 6 is 36, minus 9. Minus 1 into minus 6, 3 into 2, plus 2 into 1 into 3 and 2 into minus 6. So you will end up in delta getting the answer as minus 39. So if you find out the determinant delta for the actual matrix, you get minus 39. Now what I will do, I will find out my delta 1 by replacing the first column with the voltage matrix. So I will replace this first column with this voltage matrix in the matrix you see, minus 1, 0, minus 6. Okay, so I'll do that. So once I'll do that, I'll find out the determinant of this. So to find out the determinant of this, what is that? Minus 1 into 6 into minus 6 into minus 6, minus 3 into 3, minus 1 into 0 into minus 6, minus of minus 6 into 3, plus 2 into 0 into 3, minus of minus 6 into minus 6. So you will be ending up in getting delta 1 equals minus 117. Similarly, delta 2, you replace the second column with the voltage matrix and keep other two columns as it is, and you end up in getting delta 2 be equal to minus 78. Similarly, delta 3, you will replace two columns as it is, first two columns, whereas the third column you replace it with voltage matrix, and delta 3 you get as minus 117. Now take the ratio for delta 1 by delta, which gives you current i1, so I got 3 amps. Ratio delta 2 by delta will give you current i2, I got 2 amps. Ratio delta 3 by delta is for i3, I got again 3 amps. So these are the three mesh currents which we have solved for the problem 1. Okay, I hope this is clear to you. Now you can go back and repeat watching the problem explanation which I have done. So you will learn the concept. Now coming to the second problem. So what is second problem says here? Sorry, not second problem. I wanted to discuss one more concept here. What is that is, let us now find out how to write the matrix by looking into the network directly. How to write the matrix directly without writing the equation. Okay. So this explanation is not being found in any textbooks. This is being analyzed by me only. So it is very simple and very very efficient also, because writing equations consumes more time. In exam, if you write direct matrix also, no problem. It is nothing wrong in writing matrix directly instead of writing equations. Okay, why? Because 10 marks problem will be there, and writing matrix will again, you know, the marks will be given for writing the matrix. Okay, so not for writing the equations and all. Either You can follow writing the equation and then writing the matrix, or you can follow this method where we write matrix directly. Okay. So first thing is you need to know the skeleton of the matrix, the structure of the matrix, where R11, R12, R13, R21, R22, R23, R31, R32, R33 into I1, I2, I3 equals voltage V1, V2, V3. So this is R into I equals V, Ohm's law, right? So now our job is to construct this particular R matrix and then V matrix. Okay. So now very simple technique this is. So listen what I said. So this is the circuit which we had earlier in the previous problem, right? Mesh 1 is I1, mesh 2 is I2, mesh 3 is I3. Now when I say R11 is summation of all the resistance which is present in mesh 1. 11 means it is only mesh 1. Summation of all the resistances that we have in mesh 1. Got it? So I do have 1 ohm in mesh 1. Though it is between mesh 1 and mesh 2, we consider that to be in mesh 1. And then we also have 2 ohm which is linked to mesh 1. So therefore I'll write 1 plus 2 here. See here? 1 plus 2. Similarly, the resistance between 1 and 2. 1 and 2 means between mesh 1 and mesh 2. So the resistance between mesh 1 and mesh 2 is 1 ohm. Okay, so I'll write that as the next entry here. Similarly, the R13 is the resistance between mesh 1 and mesh 3. Mesh 1 and mesh 3. So that is 2 ohms we have between mesh 1 and mesh 3. So I'll write that. Similarly, between mesh 2 and mesh 1 is again 1 ohm. Whereas 2-2 is only the resistance present in mesh 2. So here we have 3 resistance which are present in mesh 2. 1 ohm, 3 ohm, 2 ohm. Okay, 1 ohm, 3 ohm, 2 ohm. Add all 3. That is what we do here. So 3 plus 2 plus 1. And then we have 2-3. Between the mesh 2 and mesh 3, we have 3 ohms here. So I'll write that. 3 ohms. Now coming to mesh 3 here. This is mesh 3. So what are the resistance that we have between mesh 3 and 3-1 is between 3 and 1. So between 3 and 1, I have again 2, and that will be the entry 2 here. Between 3 and 2, that is what R32. Between 3 and 2, I have 3 ohms. So I'll write that 3 ohms here. 3 and 3, so R3. It means the summation of all the resistance present in mesh 3. So I have 2 ohms, I have 3 ohms, I have 1 ohm. Add all those. 2 plus 3 plus 1. Now you got this matrix. Right? This matrix you have got. Now we'll see how to get this matrix. Now coming to the voltage source present in mesh 1. So that is what? V1 is with in terms of voltage source present in mesh 1. V2 is voltage source present in mesh 2. V3 is voltage source present in mesh 3. Okay. Now coming to V1, I'll try to take current flowing through this particular voltage source. It is plus 7. And then I'll come to 6 volts here. Minus 6. So plus 7, minus 6. You take only voltage sources. Okay. Plus 7. Minus 6. That is what I have written. 7 minus 6. Now coming to voltage source present in mesh 2. We don't have any voltage source present in mesh 2. Therefore it is 0. Coming to the voltage source in the third particular mesh. So here I3 is passing through 6 volts from minus to plus. See? Minus to plus. Therefore I will take plus 6. So plus 6 is what the voltage source that I have in mesh 3. So V1 is in terms of mesh 1. V2 is in terms of mesh 2. V3 is in terms of mesh 3. Okay. Now, what I'll do, I'll add these matrices. 2 plus 1 is 3. 1, 2, 1. 3 plus 2, 5 plus 1 is 6. 3, 2, 3. 2 plus 2, 3 is 5 plus 1 is 6. 7 minus 6 is 1, 0, 6. Now, the next method in the matrix method when you're doing, after constructing the matrix, leaving the principal diagonal matrix. I am repeating, leaving the principal diagonal matrix, all other elements should be taken as negative. Leaving the principal diagonal matrix, all other entries in the matrix should be negative. Okay, leaving the principal diagonal matrix, all other elements values should be considered as negative. So here I made as 1, 2 as minus 1, minus 2, 3,
3s minus 3, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, and 3, 6, 6 is the principal diagonal, where the polarity of that particular principal diagonal matrix will remain same and voltage remains 106 here. Now this is the matrix which we have got at the end, is the same matrix that you have got in the previous problem. So same matrix that we have got in the previous problem. So what you do in the previous problem, you multiply with minus symbol for all the entries that we have done in the matrix. Then you will see through that you get this matrix equal to that matrix. Okay. Fine. I hope this is clear to you how to write matrix directly by looking into the circuit. So from now we will not write the equation, we will write directly the matrix by looking into the circuit. So again, there is one small caution which I can put you in the exam point of view. Now if the marks is 12 marks or 13 marks or 10 marks, it is good if you try to write the equation without writing the matrix directly. But if the marks is very less and a huge network is given, for such cases you can directly write the matrix for any given circuit type. It is not wrong directly writing the matrix instead of writing the equation. But some examiners, you know, they insist you to write the equations. That is the reason I am telling you. Okay, this is the problem now. Use mesh analysis to find current Ix in the circuit shown. So what is the first method we need to apply here is what which is very important. Don't say that we have 1, 2, 3 and 4 mesh. This can be source transformation can be applied for this and be converted into voltage source in series with the resistance. Right? You can't consider this as a mesh because we have a current source here. So see, keep this in mind. When you have a current source, you cannot consider that as one single mesh. When a current source is given, that itself is a mesh current that we get. Okay, so therefore, don't consider this as a mesh. Instead of that, apply source transformation so that you can get a series branch. So that is what the first step which I did. 10 and 8 amps, 10 into 8 is 80 volts, and in series with 10 amps, arrow mark is shown towards right left side. So therefore it is plus comes left and minus goes right. So this is what the equivalent voltage source in series with the resistance for this parallel branch. So here I need to find out Ix, that is what the job is. I need to find out what is current Ix in this particular circuit. Now I will mark all the three mesh currents I1, I2, I3. I will mark all the mesh currents I1, I2, I3. Now I will write the mesh equation, or I will write the direct matrix for this particular three mesh. So it's very simple, you can directly write the matrix. So here R11 is what only the resistance connected to mesh 1. So 8 plus 4 is 12. So 8 plus 4. Between 1, 2 is what? Between 2, 1 and 2 is 4 ohms we have. So 4. Now R13 is between 1 and 3. We don't have any resistance common between 1 and 3. So you can't say 4 ohm and 3 ohms parallel. No, you can't consider like that. There should be a common resistance between 1 and 3, which is not present. So between 1 and 3, we don't have a common resistance connected between 1 and 3. Therefore, I will consider that as 0. You can't trespass mesh 2 and say between 1 and 3, we have this 4 ohms and 3 ohms. No. There should be a common resistance connection between 1 and 3, which is not there in this particular problem. Therefore, I will take it as 0. Now again, 2, 1. Between 2 and 1 is 4. 2, 2. Is the summation of all the resistance connected in mesh 2. So 4 plus 2 plus 3. And then between 2 and 3, I have 3 ohms. Now coming to 3, 1. Again, between 3 and 1, we don't have anything. So 0. 3, 2. Between 3 and 2, I have 3. 3, 3. I have 3 and 10 and 5. So 3 plus 10 plus 5. This multiplied by I1, I2, I3 equals. Now current I1 is passing mesh 1 current, V1 is mesh 1 voltage, I1 is passing through plus 100 here, right? So plus 100 volts. Then we don't have any voltage source for mesh 2, so it is considered as 0. Coming to I3, mesh 3 voltage source, we have 80 volts here. So when I3 passes through this voltage source, it goes from plus and ends with minus. So therefore minus 80. Okay. Now write the matrix again in proper format.
8 plus 4 is 12, 4, 0, 4, 4 plus 3, 7 plus 2, 9, 3, 0, 3, 10 plus 5, 15 plus 3, 18. Now this is the matrix we have got. Now leaving the principal diagonal matrix, all other elements will be considered as negative. That is what we need to do. Now into multiple y1, i2, i3, 100, 0, minus 8. Now if you look into the diagram, what is ix? Ix is nothing but i2. See, i2 is flowing through 4 ohms and then again flowing through 2 ohms. So therefore, ix is i2. So we need to find out only i2. So we need not to find out i1 and i3. So in the question, he has asked to find out, in the question, if you see, he has asked to find out the current ix. Therefore, you need not to calculate i1 and i3, only i2 if you find out, that is the solution. So to find out only i2, I need one thing is delta, and the second thing is I need delta 2. Delta 1 and delta 3 is not required now. Find out only delta 2. So delta 2 is being obtained. First I will find out delta for the determinant of this actual matrix. Okay. So that is what I am doing here. So I get delta 2 be equal to 1548. Now when I am finding out delta 2, what I will do? I will replace the second column with the voltage matrix. I will replace the second column with the voltage matrix. And then I will find out delta 2, which I will get 4320, which is determinant of this matrix is 4320. Therefore, finally, Ix equals I2 equals delta 2 by 2, which is 4320 divided by 1548. And that answer I get is Ix to be equal to 2.7906 amps. Okay, 2.7906 amps. Clear? I hope it is clear to you. Now we'll go to the next problem. Now this is the problem 3. Now again using machine current analysis, find the current through 24 ohms in the circuit shown. So he's asking you to find out the current through 24 ohms. Okay, current through 24 ohms. And this is the circuit which is given in the question. Okay, this is the circuit which is given in the question. Now, first thing is, you should see that we have a 10 amp, the current source between 10 ohms and 10 ohms. So we should try to eliminate this current source so that we get proper three different mesh here. So we need to eliminate this current source so that we get a proper three different mesh here. So how to do that? Let us see that. So first thing is, you apply source transformation this 100 volts in series with 10 ohms. You apply source transformation for 100 volts in series with this 10 ohms. So if I do that, I'll get 10 amps. Okay, if I do that, I'll get 10 amps in parallel with 10 ohms. And then I have this 10 amps and then remaining part of the circuit which is being written. Now, this 10 amps is connected across these two nodes, right? It is similar that if it is connected across these nodes. So therefore, this 10 amps and this 10 amps are in parallel. So I'll take out this 10 amps and I will just write before this 10 ohms. So this is the circuit which I get. 10 amps, 10 amps, 10 ohms, 10 ohms, 10 ohms, 10 ohms, 10 ohms, 24 ohms. So it is as good as writing across these nodes is also equal to writing 10 amps across these nodes. All these nodes are common. That is the reason I replace 10 amps position here. Why? Because I can add two current sources when they are in parallel. Therefore, 10 plus 10 is 20 because both the arrow direction is upwards. So 20 amps, and then that in turn parallel with 10 ohms and that in turn parallel with this circuit what we have. Now you convert this parallel to series again. Once you do that, I get 200 volts because 20 into 10 is 200 in series with 10 ohms and that in turn in connection with the next part of the circuit. Now you see, we got a proper three different mesh here. Now we got a proper three different mesh here where mesh 1 is this, mesh 2 is this, mesh 3 is this. So this is what you should do always in any given problem. First thing is, you should see whether you should apply the redundancy condition. Always first step is to find out the redundancy condition. Then you see whether you can apply source transformation so that your mesh analysis can be easily applied. Okay, so here in this problem I applied source transformation twice, so I got final diagram where I can easily find out the mesh diagram. Okay, so therefore now I'll immediately write the matrix. So 10 plus 10 plus 10, which is 30
okay, which is only the resistance bit for the mesh 1. Now between mesh 1 and mesh 2 I have 10, but I know leaving all principal diagonal elements I will take other elements to be negative, so I will write as minus 10. Between 1 and 3 I have 10 ohms, so I will write minus 10. Between 2 and 1, 10 ohms, so minus 10. Between 2 and 2, 10 plus 10 plus 10, 30. Principal diagonal element, so positive. Between 2 and 3 is 10 ohms, so minus 10. Between 3 and 1, 10 ohms, minus 10. Between 3 and 2, 10 ohms, minus 10. Between 3 and 3, 10 plus 10 plus 24, which is 44. This is the matrix multiplied by I1, I2, I3, which is equal to I1 is flowing through plus 200, see, plus, therefore plus 200. We don't have any voltage source for mesh 2 and we don't have any voltage source for mesh 3, therefore 0, 0. Now in the question what they have asked is to find out current through 20 ohms, 24 ohms. Therefore, our job is to find out only I3. Current through 24 ohms is only I3, okay, only I3. Therefore, our job is to find out only I3. So we know I3 is delta 3 by 3. So I will find out delta. Here delta I will end up in getting 27,200. Then I will get delta 3. I will end up in getting 80,000. Therefore, current I3 or I24 ohms, current through 24 ohms will be equal to 80,000 divided by 27,200, which I will get as 2.94 amps. I hope this is clear to you. This problem is clear to you, right? Fine. I will go to the next problem. Problem 4. They are asking you to find the output power from the voltage source using mesh current analysis for the circuit shown. So here they are asking you to find out the power. Okay. So first thing is we will write the matrix equivalent for this diagram. So first thing is we need to know what are the different mesh that are present. We have 3 mesh with these 3 currents. So directly write the matrix now. 4 plus 8 is 12. Between 1 and 2 is 8, so minus 8. Between 1 and 3 we don't have any resistance, so 0. Between 2 and 1 we have 8, so minus 8. Between 2 and 2 is 8 plus 12, which is 20. Between 2 and 3 is 12, so minus 12. Between 3 and 1 again it is 0. Between 3 and 2 is 12, so minus 12. Between 3 and 3 is 12 plus 10, which is 22. Okay. Now in the question they have given 3 mesh, okay, don't convert this parallel to one single resistance and say we have only one mesh. No, he has given this as a question and you should consider this as 3 mesh only, okay. If not, what we would have done is we would have converted this 3 parallel resistance into one single resistance and then we would have seen that we would have got one single loop. But he has mentioned this mesh currents in the question. So therefore you should consider this as 3 different mesh only. Now coming to voltage, passing from minus to plus, so 10 volts, and other two mesh we don't have any voltage source, it is 0, 0. Now I need to find out power delivered by this voltage source 10 volts, right? That is what voltage source, find the output power from the voltage source. If I need to find out the power delivered by this voltage source, my job is to find out only the current I1, because I1 is the one which is the total current which gets divided to 8 ohms and 12 ohms and 10 ohms because it is connected in parallel, right? I'll repeat, I1 is the total current passing through this branch and then it gets divided to 8 ohms and then it gets divided to 12 ohms and then it gets divided to 10 ohms. But whereas if you clearly observe, the current I1 is the total current which is got, which is the response which is been obtained due to the excitation 10 ohms. Now my job is to find out only current I1 to find out the power delivered by this voltage source 10 volts. So let me see how to find out current I1. We all know that it is delta 1 by delta. Before that, we'll see what is the power equation. We have 3 different equations to find out the power. We know that it is V into I. We know V square by R if you take resistance. Similarly, we have I square into R. I square into R or V square by R. Or V into I. All these 3 equations are used to find out the power. Therefore V into I here, where V is the total voltage source which is given as 10 volts. Now I is what? I1. Total current. So therefore power P equals V into I1.
Therefore, I1 can be equal to delta 1 by delta. Now we know how to find out delta, the matrix determinant of the matrix, the actual matrix, which you get 2144. Now coming to delta 1 is replacing the first column with the voltage matrix. So 10, 0, 0 and retaining the other two columns. And finally, you will end up in getting delta 1 to be equal to 2960. So therefore, when you take I1 to be equal to delta 1 by delta, you get 2960 by 2144. You will get I1 to be equal to 1.380. Okay, 1.380 is the solution for I1. Therefore, power P equals V into I1. Therefore, V was 10 volts multiplied by 1.380. You get power to be equal to 13.8 watts. Your writing unit is very, very important. 13.8 W or 13.8 watts is what power that you get. Clear? I hope all these problems which I am explaining to you is clear to you. I hope you are getting my explanation, and you are also solving with me so that you will be able to learn much better. Now coming to the next problem. Problem 5. Obtain the voltage Vx in the network shown. Voltage Vx is between these 10 ohms in the figure using mesh current analysis. Now let me tell you, this problem, whatever it is being given, is purely AC network. Till now we were working on DC. Now we have a circuit which has an AC network. Now when we keep our step into AC network, our job is first to find out the method used in converting rectangular to polar form and polar to rectangular form using the calculator. I'll repeat. We will first now learn how to convert rectangular to polar and then polar to rectangular, and then we'll continue with this problem.
Okay, students, so let us see how to find out the rectangular to polar or polar to rectangular form. So rectangular to polar or polar to rectangular form is what we need to learn now, because when we have an AC circuits like this, we need to first see how to convert polar to rectangular or rectangular to polar. Okay, so here when you have a term called 3 plus 4j, so let us consider an example. Okay, 3 plus 4j is an example. This is actually a rectangular form, a plus bj format, whatever you have. This is the rectangular form. Now this rectangular form should be converted into a polar form. Polar form will always have the format a plus a at an angle some b degree. Okay, this is the polar form. So now we need to find out this polar form for this given question, rectangular 3 plus 4j. So for that, we can do this in the calculator. So I'll show you how to do that in the calculator. That is the reason why I'm showing this. So we'll see how to do this in the calculator. So calculator is on now. So let me on the calculator. Okay. Now press shift. Shift should be pressed so that the polar is here. Okay. The polar is here. Polar, shift, polar off, see, polar off. 3 plus 4j, therefore 3, and then you should type comma. So comma, for comma you should press shift, and then you see comma is here. Okay, top of on the top you can see yellow color comma. So comma, so I got comma here, and then 4, press 4, close the bracket. So this is how it looks, polar of 3 comma 4, and then press equals. Okay, now you will get an answer here. R equals 5, theta is 53.13010. Therefore, here polar, the rectangular form 3 plus 4j is equal to 5 at an angle 53.130 degree. So this is what the answer. Okay, so this 5 plus 53.34, this is the polar form. This is the polar form. Whereas this 3 plus 4j is the rectangular form. Rectangular form.
Now think that we will be given a polar form now. So let us see how to convert a polar to rectangular now. Polar to rectangular. Okay, polar to rectangular, let us see. Now polar to rectangular, for example, we have for example think that I have some value, like for example phi at an angle 30 degree. Okay, so this is the polar form. Now how to convert this into rectangular form? So let us see how to convert this into rectangular form. So again we'll go to the calc. Okay, so here in the calculator, again press shift, then go to the rectangular term here. So I hope you can see rectangular term, whatever you have here in the minus symbol, can you see here? So this is rectangular. So press rectangular, so you get see REC of rectangular of. So I should find out for what? Phi at an angle 30 degree. Therefore, phi comma, again you should go with the, so here comma should be obtained. So again press the shift and then press on comma. So the, again here it is the comma, can you see comma? So this is rectangular of phi comma 30 degree. So 3 and then 0. So here phi at an angle 30 degree. Okay, phi at an angle 30 degree. Now close the bracket. Close the bracket. Okay, and then just press equals. See, I will get two different values, x and y here. So here x equals 4.3301. Now you keep on pressing this right button. So this right button. So you get y. Y equals 2.5. Therefore, how will you write this here is, phi at an angle 30 degree equals 4.3301 plus 2.5j. This is how you write, 4.3301 plus 2.5j. So this is the polar form phi at an angle degree 30 degree, and this is the rectangular form 4.3301 plus 2.5j. The reason why we do this here is because think that m at an angle n degree in the numerator and you have a at an angle b degree in the denominator, this can be done as m by a at an angle n minus b degree. So you can easily subtract the angle when it is divided, and then you try to take the ratio of the coefficient m and a. This is how it is very simple when you have polar form. Similarly, when you have m at an angle n degree into a at an angle b degree, you can easily write m into a at an angle n plus b degree. Okay, when you have into, you can easily add the angles and then you multiply the coefficients. Okay, but if you have, for example, m at an angle n degree plus a at an angle b degree. Now if you have an addition here, this is not equal to m plus a plus b, n plus b. Okay, this is not equal. Not equal means you can't write this. So in order to overcome with this plus, when you have, what you do is you convert this into rectangular and you convert this into rectangular. For example, I get x plus yj for m at an angle 90 n degree plus for a underscore b degree, I will get w plus zj, for example. Now for m at an angle n degree, I got the rectangular form x plus yj, and for a at an angle b degree, I got w plus zj. So if I have got in this sense, then therefore I can easily say the equivalent value is x plus w. So I add the term which is not having j, and I will add the term which is having j. So plus y plus z into j. So this x plus yj plus w plus zj can be written as this: x plus w plus y plus z into j. So this is the reason why we convert into polar, rectangular. From polar to rectangular we convert when you have addition like this, and then we convert like this, and then we add like this. Understood? But when you have a polar in division or multiplication, it is very simple. You can write in this sense. So this is the benefit of converting polar to rectangular or rectangular to polar. Thank you.
Okay, students. So I have explained to you just now how to use the calculator to convert polar to rectangular and rectangular to polar. Now we will see how to solve this problem using mesh analysis. So in a similar way we write the matrix for this also, for this particular AC network also. So we do write matrix for this AC network also. So we'll see how to write that. So before that we need to know the number of mesh that are available in this particular network. So we do have three mesh, which is I1, I2 and I3. Okay, so three different mesh we have, which is I1, I2 and I3. Okay, now as we have learnt already with the usage of calc, so we'll just directly go into the problem. So now this is the matrix which we have written based on the circuit. So here this is the circuit. So what was it? It is given here is, so R11 is what? Summation of all these three resistance with this reactance. So it is 2 ohms, 5j ohms minus 2j ohms is plus 3j ohms. So 2 ohms plus 3j ohms is plus 5 ohms. So 7. So you get 7 plus 3j. 7 plus 3j is the total resistance of the mesh 1. Between 1 and 2 we have 5j, so minus 5j. Between 1 and 3 we have 5 ohm, so minus 5 ohm. Similarly, if you go to R21, between 2 and 1 5j, so minus 5j. 2 and 2 add this resistance, so you have 10 plus 2 is 12 plus 5 minus 2 is 3, therefore 12 plus 3j. And then 2, 3 is minus 2 plus 2j, because minus of 2 minus 2j is minus 2 plus 2j. Okay. Now 3, 1 is minus 5. 3, 2 is again minus of 2 minus 2j is minus 2 plus 2j. And then 3, 3 is 10 plus 5 plus 2. So 10 plus 5 is 15 plus 2 is 17. 17 minus 2j. So therefore that is the matrix which you can see in this particular problem. Okay, so this is 7 plus 3j minus 5j minus 5 minus 5j, 12 plus 3j minus 2 plus 2j minus 5 minus 2 plus 2j, 17 minus 2j, multiplied by I1, I2, I3. Now here voltage is what? Now current moves from this diagram, if you see, current moves from minus to plus. Therefore 10 at an angle 0 degree is the voltage source that we have in mesh 1. Mesh 2 is also connected to a voltage source here. So when I2 moves towards plus 2 minus, therefore minus 5 at an angle 30 degree. Now mesh 3 doesn't have any source, so it is 0. So it is 10 at an angle 0 degree, minus 5 at an angle 30 degree and 0. Now we need to find out Vx. In the question they have asked to find out Vx. Vx is what? Voltage across 10 ohms. Now if I want to find out voltage across 10 ohms, what should I do? I need current through 10 ohms. Now what is the current through 10 ohms if you look into the diagram? It is I3. Therefore I need to find out just I3 so that I can get the current through 10 ohms, and then therefore Vx would be equal to 10 into I3. Okay. So we'll see that now, how to find out I3. Now Cramer's rule says I3 equals delta 3 by delta. Okay. Now delta 3 by delta is what the equation that we have. So we need to find out what is delta 3. So you all know that first of all we will find delta, and then we'll see how to find out delta 3. Now here delta equals 7 plus 3j multiplied by this 2 multiplication minus this 2. So 12 plus 3j into 17 minus 2j minus of minus 2 plus 2j into minus 2 plus 2j. that added with 5j, y addition minus of minus 5j, therefore plus 5j into minus 5j into 17 minus 2j, minus of minus 5, so plus 5, so plus 5. So here we have calculated, we have multiplied minus 5j with 17 minus 2j, minus of minus 5 into, so minus of minus 5 is plus 5 into minus 2 plus 2j you will get. So therefore this minus 5 is again multiplied with minus 5j into minus 2 plus 2j, minus of minus is plus 5 into 12 plus 3j. So this is the three terms you get with the delta. Solve it. You all know that j into j, j square is minus 1 in complex number. Therefore j square is minus 1. Keep that in mind. So once you multiply all these terms and you get with 204 plus 51j minus 24j plus 6 minus of 4 minus 4j minus 4j minus 4. Now here you get for totally minus 85j minus 10 plus 10j multiplied by 5j, then 10j plus 10 plus 60 plus 15j into 5. So you solve it. You try to multiply each term and then see addition you will do. Here 5j, 12 into 17 is 204. 17 into 3 is 51j. Minus 12 into 2 is 24j. Now 3 into 2 is 6. Minus 6. J square is minus 1. So minus 1 into minus 6 is plus 6. Similarly, you multiply this 2, you get this. So similarly, you multiply all this, you get this. Then again, you multiply this, you get this. So once you get all these terms, solve it further. It's all simple mathematics what you have. Solve it further. And finally, you will end up with delta equals 1390 plus 650j. Okay. Now, you convert that rectangular form to polar form. I will get 1534.470 at an angle 25.062. Fine. So therefore now we'll find out what is delta 3. Delta 3 is been found by converting the polar to rectangular to polar I have done here. So I have taken this 7 plus 3j. Now here you have replaced the third column with the voltage column matrix. 10 at 10 angle 0, minus 5 at 10 angle 30, 0, because I am finding out delta 3 here. Now this matrix, whatever I have rectangular terms along with the polar form. Therefore, my job is to find out what is the polar form of these two column matrix, columns of this particular matrix. Then I will get all in polar forms. Then we know that multiplication in terms of polar form, angles get added and coefficients get multiplied. So that is what I have done here. So these two, and then 5 at an angle, minus 5 at an angle. So 7.61 at an angle 23.19 multiplied by these two multiplied. So minus of minus plus 5 at an angle 30 degree multiplying by 2.82 at an angle 135 degree. So you do that further. At the end, we will be having this equation. 107.301 at an angle 188.19 plus 125 at an angle minus 60 degree plus 141 at an angle 45 degree plus 6,618 at an angle 14.03 degree. Now you can't add the polar form equations. You can't add the polar terms. So therefore I need to convert again this into rectangular form. So here this is converted into rectangular, this is converted into rectangular, again this is converted, this is converted. Now what will I do? I will add all the numerical terms and I will add all the j terms. Means add or subtract, it depends on minus and plus. So you will end up in getting 655.56 plus 125.99j. Finally, if you convert this rectangular to polar, I will get delta 3 to be equal to 667.55 at an angle 10.87 degree. Therefore, I3 equals delta 3 by delta. Therefore, 667.55 at an angle 10.87 divided by 1534.470 at an angle 25.062. So therefore, you divide these two coefficients and you subtract this particular angle when it is division. Therefore, I get 0.43 at an angle minus 14.192 amps. Okay, you need to write amps here. Now, we know that Vx is 10 into I3.
Therefore, 10 multiplied by 0.43 is 4.3 at an angle minus 14.192 volts. This is the solution for this problem. I hope you got it. Now coming to next problem. So problem 6. Use mesh current analysis to find the various currents flowing in the network shown in below figure. Now here we do have a loop here. We do have a loop here, which is a mesh. We do have second mesh, third mesh. We have three different mesh. But one thing you need to observe in this problem is you do have a redundancy condition here, right? You can't find a current source in series with the resistance. Therefore, I'll keep current source as it is and I'll remove this resistance and create a short circuit here. So I'll get this equivalent circuit. Okay, where I1 is this mesh 1, I2 for mesh 2 and I3 is for mesh 3. Now, again, we do have a different issue here. What is that? To write a KVL, you need to have all voltage source in this loop. But here we do have a current source. So therefore, when you have a current source in common between two different mesh, when you have a current source in common between two different mesh, then such mesh will behave as a super mesh. Okay, when you have a current source in common between any two mesh, then that two mesh together is called as a super mesh by keeping currents as it is. Okay. So, by keeping current as it is. Now, this is the super mesh which I have written. By removing the current source, you will see that this entire loop A, B, G, D, E, F, A will be the super mesh. Now, we will see how to handle this case in my problem now. So, once we have a super mesh, the steps here is first write the equation for the current source. So, the step is first write the equation for the current source. So you will write equation for the current source first. So for this current source, we will write the equation. Step 2 is then write the equation for the super mesh. Then write the equation for the super mesh. So I take the super mesh and I will write the equation for that super mesh. Step 3 is continue further with other mesh equation. So I have written the equation for this current source. I have written the equation for the super mesh. Now I am left out with another mesh here. So I will write the equation for this particular another mesh. Now, finally, in step 4, find the solution using Cramer's rule. That is what we do. Okay. Now we will see how to find out the solution for this problem. So first of all, we'll write the equation for the current source. So how to write the equation for the current source here is, now current source is between common between I1 and I3, right? Mesh 1 and mesh 3. I1, when it is flowing through this current source, it is flowing in the same direction as 5 amps, where I3 is in the opposite direction of 5 amps. Therefore, 5 amps is equal to I1 flowing towards 5 amps minus I3, which is in opposite. Therefore, I1 minus I3 will be equal to 5 amps. I1 minus I3 equals 5 amps. Now the next step is writing the equation for the super mesh. Now let us write the equation for the super mesh A, B, G, D, E, F, A. So therefore, I'll just go back to the super mesh. Now you see, plus 10 volts. Minus 5 times I1 because only I1 is flowing here. Minus 2 into I1 minus I2. Right? 2 into I1 minus I2. Minus 4 into I3 minus I2 because I am writing the equation for mesh. Therefore, I will consider I3. Minus 4 into I3 minus I2. Minus 8 into I3 equals 0. So, therefore, that is what we write here. So, 10 minus 5 times I1. Minus 2 into I1 minus I2, minus 4 into I3 minus I2, minus 8 times I3 equals 0. Now when you solve this, you will get 7I1 minus 6I2 plus 12I3 equals 10. Now I1 minus I3 equals 5, whatever the current source equation you have written, that will behave as first equation. Whereas this equation, whatever you have written for super mesh, will become the second equation. Now the third equation, whatever we will write, is for the another mesh, remaining mesh. Now this is the remaining mesh. We'll write the equation for this now. So what will I get? Minus 2 into I2 minus I1. Then coming here, minus 6 into I2. Minus 4 into I2 minus I3 equals 0. When I'm writing for I2, I'll take I2 minus I1 and I2 minus I3. Therefore, minus 2 into I1, I2 minus I1, minus 6 I2, minus 4 into I2 minus I3 equals 0. Therefore, that is the third equation we will get for the remaining group. So, when you solve this minus 6 I2 minus 4 into I2 minus I3 minus 2 into I2 minus I1 equals 0, I will get 2 I1 minus 12 I2 plus 4 I3 equals 0. Now I'll write the matrix format of the above three equations. So I'll get 1, 0, minus 1, 7, minus 6, 12, 2, minus 12, 4, multiplied by I1, I2, I3, which is equal to 5, 10, 0, which is this voltage source. Now, I1 equals delta 1 by delta, I2 is delta 2 by delta, I3 is delta 3 by delta. Now we know that delta is the matrix of the determinant of the matrix itself. 1 into minus 6 into 4, minus of minus plus 12 into 12, minus 0 into anything is 0, minus 1 into 7 into minus 12, plus 6 into 2, minus of minus 6 is plus 6 into 2. So I get delta 2 equal to 192. Now coming to delta 1, I will replace voltage source, voltage column matrix in terms of first column. I will replace the first column with the voltage column matrix and I will keep other two columns as it is. So this we have done earlier in the previous problem. So just solve what is delta 1. So you get 720. Similarly, solve for delta 2 by replacing the second column with the voltage column matrix and keeping other two columns as it is, you get delta 2 equal to 40. Similarly, you do for delta 3, replace the third column with the voltage column matrix and keep other two columns as it is, you get delta 3 to be equal to minus 240. Therefore, find out I1, which is delta 1 by delta, we get 3.75 amps. I2 is delta 2 by delta, you get 0.208 amps. I3 is delta 3 by delta, you get minus 1.25 amps. Now these are the three current values which we have got is the solution for this particular problem. Okay. Now let us solve the next problem. So problem 7. Again, find loop currents I1 and I2 for the circuit shown below. So earlier we had a normal current source. Now we have a dependent current source in common between two different mesh. And again we do have a redundancy condition where 6 ohm is connected in series with this particular current source. So now my job is to find out the mesh currents I1 and I2 for this particular problem. So therefore, let us see how to find out the currents I1 and I2. So now first thing is we remove this redundancy condition and we'll write the equivalent circuit diagram like this. So here I1, I2, I3. Now, as we have a dependent source, even though it is a dependent source and it is a current source which is in common between two mesh, again we will see that this mesh 1 and mesh 3 will be a super mesh. Okay, mesh 1 and mesh 3 will be again a super mesh because you have a current source, though it is a dependent source but still it is a current source which is in common between mesh 1 and mesh 3. Therefore, the first job is to write the equation for this current source. And then write the equation for the super mesh and then write the equation for the remaining mesh and then you will see how the answer has been found. Okay. Now we will write the equation for the current source which is I3 minus I1. Why? Because I3 is in the direction flowing towards Vx, whereas I1 is in reverse. Therefore, I3 minus I1 equals 1 by 8 Vx, equals 1 by 8 Vx, where Vx equals
Vx equals what? Voltage across 3 ohms. Right? Voltage across 3 ohms is Vx. So I'll take Vx as I2 minus I3 multiplied by 3. Or you can take I3 minus I2 multiplied by 3. Anything you can take. So I'll take I2 by minus I3 multiplied by 3 is equal to Vx. Now you replace that Vx in this equation and you will get equation in terms of I3 minus 10. Why 10 here? Because in this particular problem, when current flows through this 10 ohms, when current flows through this 10 amps, I1 equals 10 amps. When current flows through this 10 amps, I1 is 10 amps. Therefore, I1 will be equal to 10 amps. I3 minus 10 equals 3 by 8 into I2 minus I3. Once you solve this, you will end up in equation minus 3 I2 plus 11 I3 equals 80. Now, this is the equation which we have got because of this current source. Now, the second equation what we write is for the super mesh. So, therefore, the super mesh equation is minus 5 times I2 minus I1, minus 4 times I2, minus 3 times I2 minus I3 equals 0. This is the super mesh equation. And you will end up in getting a second equation which is minus 12 I2 plus 3 I3 equals minus 50. Now you got, so I will not write the equation for this third mesh. The reason is I1 is already been found as 10 amps. I1 is already been found as 10 amps. And I have got two equations already to find out I2 and I3. So I need not to write the equation for this third mesh. Okay, so therefore I have the two equations which I'll take here. Minus 3, 11, minus 12 and 3 multiplied by I2 and I3, which is equal to 80 and minus 50. Therefore, now my job is to find out I2 and I3. In the question they have asked to find out I1 and I2, but let me find out I1 is already been found, which is 10 amps. Therefore, let me find I2 and I3. Now you all know that delta equals the determinant of the actual matrix, where 123 is the answer which I get. Whereas I2 will be equal to delta 1 by delta, where delta 1 is 80 minus 50 is replaced with the first column, and then we have a second column as 113. So therefore you will find out the determinant of this, which is equal to 790. Delta 2 is minus 3 minus 12. Second column is replaced with the voltage column matrix 80 and minus 50. Therefore I will get delta 2 equal to 1110. Therefore, I2 will be delta 1 by delta, I3 equals delta 2 by delta, where I2 I will get 6.42 amps and I3 is 9.024 amps. Now, these are the two solutions that we have for this particular problem. Okay, now this ends up in discussion on mesh analysis. In my next video, we will also see some more AC networks which have been solved using mesh analysis. Thank you.